guess in my native language we say g'day. So I was laughing when I watched Marc Gauvin say, you know, here's France and here's where I learned to speak with a French accent. So I'm a Kiwi, and I came to the United States actually in a very long time ago, 1968. My dad got a scholarship to Columbia University, and my parents split up and my dad stayed. And so I've spent my whole life kind of coming back and forth between New Zealand and the US. And one of the things that I really notice is that more and more we are global citizens, and the more people I've talked to today, we're global citizens, all of us. And I've been an entrepreneur now for over 20 years. I studied at Rutgers University, and I joke that it was perfect. I studied hazardous waste management, more RCRA sites than you can, you know, shake a stick at. If you wanted to learn about hazardous waste, just had to look out the window. And, you know, I arrived there just after the Port Elizabeth fire, and it was a fascinating time. So I graduated half in hazardous waste management, the other half in environmental epidemiology. And I went back to New Zealand to work eventually, and I worked in the energy sector for 12 years as a hazardous waste manager, and I started a consultancy in clean production 20 years ago, and very quickly realised I was going to go broke. And today I keep wandering around meeting people that I keep thinking, there's no virtue in being 20 years early, you know? Just none at all, right? And so I quickly segued my company into occupational safety and health, where I could make money. And eventually, I got more and more interested in software. But while I was studying, I bought my first modem, which I laugh, is about the size of that speaker there. And I used to sit at home in New Jersey, and I used to dial up data on the internet. And I'm using a thing called a Kermit and a Gopher, and it's great because I can see a few people nodding. And for anyone probably under 35 in the room, you don't know this, but we used to have to write code to get on the net. And I started hacking in 1986, all right? So a proud hacker tradition. And the librarians at the university, who are probably the same, you know, like in New Zealand we said they had mouths like cat's bottoms, you know what I mean? And there was no way those librarians were letting me on the net, right? And they were the only people who knew the secret codes. But it was really good because cat seemed to be one of the best passwords they had. You know, like, as long as you could get to know these women, you could figure out their passwords really, really well. I've never forgotten the one whose password was poodle. You know, like, so easy. So I still admire hackers. And so a few years ago, I finally built up this big workers' comp company, and I designed a whole lot of software systems, and I sold it, and I decided to take some time off. And I got back into the software business about 10 years ago. And in that time, I had my second child. So my first child is 28 and lives in London and is a trainee producer and a film editor. And my youngest is 10. And I don't have any in between. And when my oldest was little, I was an entrepreneur. I was a single mom in those days. And I used to need those Saturday morning sleep-ins. And so he would wake me up every now and then because the tape and the video would jam, right? I know. And so this time round, right, I'm lying in bed Saturday morning thinking, oh, I suppose I should make coffee. And my three-year-old comes in and she goes, Mom, the wireless is down. And because we're kind of an Apple home, and I don't know if there's anyone from Apple here, but it was a huge disappointment when they took that little hole that you could fix everything with a paperclip. You know, like, it was amazing, right? You could just poke that paperclip in the back. And she told me, I've already tried the paperclip. And so she'd been up, she'd poked a few holes in the back of the modem, nothing was working. And I got really interested in, well, honey, what are you doing on the internet? And one of the things that disturbed me was the more I looked at what was available for kids of my daughter's generation, the more horrified I was, and the more cynical I felt about what I was seeing. And particularly, I started reading all this literature, and here was my child being described as an eyeball. And everywhere I looked was all this stuff about how children of this generation, so we're talking about the kids who aspire to be Erin one day, right? I'm talking here about the kids who are under 12. And you read the literature on them as consumers, and it's fascinating. And I'm just going to give you a little bit of that background. But what I wanted to do when I started this company is I wanted to take all those geeky skills that I have, and literally I have been online now for 25 years, and I wanted to take those skills and I wanted to really think about how we use them to make a difference. And before I go too much further, I want to show you this picture because one of the things you may or may not know about New Zealanders is some of the reason we like hanging out in California is that we're outdoorsy people. And I made it on our sports station on television last year. I was pretty excited. First time I've ever been featured in sports TV. And I was the inspiring grandma section, you know? It's fabulous. So I have been ocean swimming, racing seriously now. I've had two seasons off in 35 years. And you may or may not know this about New Zealand, but the weather's actually a lot like it is here in Monterey. You know, it gets up to 11 degrees, that's when we start swimming in the sea. So that's 11 degrees Fahrenheit, I don't know what that is, about 45 or something ridiculous. You know, it's freezing, right? And so in the off-season, I kayak. And a few years ago, I was down in the South Island, and my daughter and I are kayaking, and you can see there's a tiny bit at the bottom of that picture, a little yellow bit, that's my kayak. And that's my daughter in the other kayak. And behind us, you'll see something that looks a bit like a dirty rock. And my father-in-law and I were sitting around, and I said, I'm going to take the family up. We're going to go kayak on Lake Muller. And he went, there's no lake at Lake Muller. And I went, yeah, there's a lake. And he pulled out his map, and I pulled out my map, and we were both right. And 20 years ago, this was not a lake. And as you can see, there's definitely a lake here now. And I took this photo on my phone to prove to my father-in-law there was a lake. Behind me is, this thing looks like a dirty rock. It's the terminal face of a glacier, it's the terminal moraine. And about 17 years ago, this started melting. And when I was watching the Inconvenient Truth movie, I got really angry. So I thought, you know, Mel, you studied this in 1986 at university. And I was like, yeah. And those chats you have with yourself, like I was in my 20s. And you go, you know, they told me that in 25 years this stuff would happen. And I remember thinking that 25 years just was impossible, right? Not just that it would happen, but that I would be that old, right? Isn't that amazing? And so I'm up here, and a couple of things started to come together for me. I watched the movie, and I have to say this, like, I hated the movie. And the reason I hated the movie is I was already, right? Like, I watched the movie, I'm like, so tell me what to do, Al. I'm really excited, I'm all dressed, I'm ready to go. And then as the credits are rolling, if you're still in the theater, it told me to change the light bulbs and start composting. It was just astonishing, and it's like, I've been doing that, right? I'm a hippie child. I've been doing that my entire life, right? I garden, I have chickens, I live downtown. I have the smallest little footprint you can imagine apart from my travel. And you're telling me to start changing my light bulbs? Get a grip. And so I did what a normal hacker would do. I started emailing Al, right? It's amazing, like al@aol.com, al@yahoo.com. And, you know, just in case any of you are not hackers, like basically this is pay dirt when some aide wrote to me and told me to stop. Yes, I've got your email address. Unbelievable, right? And so I was like, Al, you know, I hear you're going to train 1,000 people to present the Inconvenient Truth. You have to pick me. Like, as you can see, I'm here. Opinionated, articulate, from another part of the world. You know, I'll go and do this stuff. And they're like, no, Americans, they're the most polluting, no room for you. Yeah, so I kept spamming them. And then I went on Facebook and I said, does anyone know anyone who knows Al, right? And LinkedIn, and eventually I discovered that in 1987, I had been to dinner at his chief of staff's place. I didn't know he was the chief of staff at the time, I just knew his wife through another friend. So I wrote to them, I went, look, I came for dinner in 1987. I'm sure it's wonderful, I really hope I said thank you. Yeah, could you take me on? And I hear you're going to Australia, and could I come to Australia and train? And they're like, no, the Australian's second biggest footprint. You know, you can't come. And one of the good things that happened to me was that they decided to make two slots for India. And the Indians couldn't come. So I was the first Indian to train to present the Inconvenient Truth slideshow. And I'll tell you about that because one of the things I realized is that we needed to start really moving to a solutions focus. And I've now presented that slideshow over 50 times. I've emceed for Al, who is now finally talking to me, in Melbourne, and I take the message around the world. But at the same time, this phenomenon is going on, and this is Q1 data for children in virtual worlds. So you'll see over there 272 million individual accounts for kids 5 to 10 in the world, in virtual worlds. And if you don't know about this space, I'm not surprised, but you really should. And you can see since Q1 of 2009 just how much that's grown. A little bit about the kind of boys that I'm interested in. Sounds tragic, doesn't it? Anyway, I have about 2,500 boys follow me on Twitter, which is not as creepy as it sounds. But here in the US, there are 40 million kids, 5 to 14. So these are different ways of cutting the data. I couldn't get it exactly the way I wanted. But on average, the American kid spends 2 hours, 42 minutes a day online. Pretty amazing, isn't it? They're often doing other things, right? So I think about my little 10-year-old, and she's watching on-demand television while Skyping her friends and playing Nintendo. And that's really typical. And a lot of them have their own laptops, and a lot of them have internet in their own rooms. Whoops, wrong way. The other thing is that 91% of US tween boys, 93% of tween girls play games online. And disturbingly, 75% of US 7 to 12th graders have some kind of social media profile. And they use social media more than they use games and video. It's no surprise to you, but you guys, like, you're the most anxious people I've ever met in my life. I'm serious, you know, like laid-back Kiwis and Australians. And so we come here, and as an outsider, I would have thought, because I'm constantly being searched, right? You know, it's just trying to get into this country is phenomenal. So, and it has improved, I have to say. But, you know, I would have thought terrorism was right up there. But the survey that was done of American kids last year, 60% of US kids feel global warming and environmental issues. It was the number one. So this is at the top four for US kids last year. And interestingly, 30% worry a lot about the impact of global warming on their lives. And 60% of them want their communities to do something else about it. And we're way down for terrorism, car crashes, other things. I pulled this off my Facebook page yesterday morning because I thought about it and I thought it's really interesting. You know, we're constantly having stuff. So I get the toy news. It's amazing what the 10 most horrible plastic things you're going to be asked to pay for this Christmas are. This Barbie one, I don't know if anyone's seen it. I got it posted 3 times yesterday to my wall. This was the least offensive. The other one I got was, does Barbie hate orangutans? Amazing, isn't it? And some of you will have seen the Nestle Kit Kat ad. There's a bunch of these, and these go around our social media really fast now. Really, really fast. And this bottom one, I don't know if you guys are aware of this, this one, I have had a new post on my Facebook page from someone somewhere in the world every day for 12 days about these astonishing girls here in the US who have been taking on the Girl Scouts. They're Girl Scouts, and they don't want to sell the cookies because of the palm oil in the cookies. And they're amazing girls. They're getting their way onto MBS, on, you know, they're on NBC, they were on CBS News, and they're everywhere. And these kids are using this technology now. So this is a bit about writing. What got me here is that 13% of UK kids under 12 had a website. 24% of them blog, which is not unusual. So I think you actually have to ask a different question, which is, what if we don't need to teach these kids anything at all? And I was thinking about it the other day, we had a comment about Buckminster Fuller and that we have this as expectation that children are a vessel we need to fill. They don't. They already know this stuff. What we have to do is keep them connected for as long as possible. So my site is here. Interesting, the industry analyst called us the kind of perfect spot between social gaming and social media for children. The kids who belong to us, so we've just launched a virtual world for kids where community and sustainability are key. And from the kids themselves, particularly after a couple of them started blogging on palm oil, we've taken on an orangutan project in Indonesia. For every time a child buys one of our products, a kid literally buys another kid clean water in India. They can do things in the world where they play games that all have environmental messages underneath to do with gardening or composting or things. The thing that I think we most need to give our children is agency. We don't need to teach them anything. We need to teach them how to have power. because these kids, as Erin said, they have the more power than any other young generation ever. And we need to give them agency. Don't you think so? Yeah. So this is a quote from Seth Godin, you know, major marketer. Either you have capacity to act in the world or you don't. And what we have to do is maintain these children's ability to act in the world so that they have the skills to deal with the mess that we leave behind. This little girl on my left here, she picked up 1,800 cigarette butts off a beach after joining our site. The other kid over here, she had a fashion show at school and she decided instead of doing what she was supposed to do, she would make a dress from drinking straws that she collected. Isn't that amazing? I've got a quick video, I'm not going to play it, but if anyone wants to come and see me later, we can. I just want to show these quotes. Earlier this year, I launched a thing called the Green Eco Monkey Project. My goal is to have 1 million kids take on environmental leadership roles in their communities. And we just put the first 50 through a program, and these are some quotes from the kids who are doing it. And I just love it because we talked over this week, there's been a lot of discussion about fear and love. And these kids are already afraid, right? They can read the paper, they hear the news, they follow on Twitter, they know about this stuff. Well, what we can do is encourage them to have confidence in their ability to control their future. And so I love these quotes from, they're from real little boys, a lot of them in your communities, that say things like, I feel good because I'm helping to save the earth. I feel proud of myself because nobody else wanted to do this with me, so I thought I was a good person to do this, and it helped the earth. This was a 9-year-old boy who waded into an almost frozen lake by himself with a bag and collected plastic out of the lake while his friend videoed it on a phone, and then they submitted it to us. And we give them virtual rewards for doing good work. On my birthday, they sent me this most amazing card. These kids don't even know each other's real names. And they sent it around by Twitter, and they sent it around by email, and then they gave me a link for a twit pic. And then they asked me to go on camera, on a video cam, so that they could watch my face when I opened it on Twitter. Isn't that cool? I cried. I cry like almost every day at work. So I just want to say thank you, and I want you to really think about that. We don't have to teach these children anything. What we need to do is to give them the space to really flourish, to be who they are, and to let them believe that they can change the world. Thank you.